The missionary activity of women in mission, women in the church and in the world, both past and present, remains mostly unknown and unrecognized. We present the exceptional life and mission of one extraordinary French woman, Euphrasie Barbier. Her Trinitarian theology and spirituality, her daring and breadth of vision, continues to challenge and inspire RNDM women, who embrace the same contemplative spirit and missionary zeal today in this 21st century world that impelled their foundress to journey to the ends of the earth. We offer an energetic representation of the dynamism of religious women and their central place in the universal mission of the Church. Euphrasie Barbier, a remarkable and courageous Frenchwoman, held an intuitive insight into the mystery of God present in the world, through the humanity of Jesus and through the power and passion of the Spirit. She recognized that humankind is called to share in the divine missions. Her expression of this gift as communion, contemplation, and mission laid a solid and profound theological and spiritual foundation for the Sisters of Our Lady of the Missions. Euphrasie perceives Mary, a woman of Visitation and Pentecost, as totally open and completely receptive to God's action within her. This woman of the Visitation is the missionary who moves beyond boundaries of geography, age, religion, and cultural expectation. Mary, the instrument of the divine missions, is presented by Euphrasie as the icon of the missionary woman that each RNDM may well emulate. At the beginning of this third millennium, in a congregation born of missionary enthusiasm, which marked the church in Europe in the 19th century, RNDMs are challenged anew to incarnate the fundamental intuition of Euphrasie into the reality of a profoundly changing world. Let us journey through the story since the beginning. Adèle Euphrasie Barbier, eldest daughter of Louis Barbier and Jeanne Adèle Leclerc, born in Cannes, Normandy on the 4th of January, 1829. On her mother's side, Euphrasie inherited the stability and wisdom of the Leclerc and Planquette families, who for generations knew no other boundaries than those of their home villages, Louvigny and Vesson. In the Vargau region of Cannes, where her father, born in Guadeloupe, was a shoemaker by trade, and where, at 17, she sets up a laundry business among an industrious, hard-working people. It is here that Euphrasie developed a sense of honesty and pride in a job well done. While very young, Euphrasie listened to the stories of her father and grandmother of the enchanted islands of Aix and Emerald, so different from the narrow streets of Caen. At this early age, her desire to consecrate herself to God and to the foreign missions was growing deep within her. The attraction for distant missions was inherited from within her family. In 1848, with the consent of her parents, Euphrasie entered the congregation of the Sisters of Calvary in Cuves, Haute-Marne, a congregation newly founded by Abbé Chantôme for the missions. In 1851, she pronounced her vows in Cuves. To the usual three vows, she added a vow of zeal. At this time, the Cuves community immigrated to England to make a fresh start after many trials and suffering. Euphrasie came to know the heartache of exile in a foreign land and the privations of extreme poverty. She remained in London for 10 years, working in education and service to the poor with the Sisters of Compassion. the name taken by the Couve community in England. However, under the guidance of a Father Faber, superior of the Oratorians, the missionary orientation of this congregation became blurred. Sister Marie, as she was now called, became disorientated and passed through a period of doubt and suffering. In 1861, having been deposed by an abrupt decision of the superior from the office of assistant and mistress of novices, she obtained permission from Rome to leave the Sisters of Compassion. Sister Marie wished to follow her initial missionary call to consecrate her life to the foreign missions. She contacted the Marist Sisters and the Marist Fathers, who were seeking teaching sisters for the Bishop of Wellington in New Zealand. Sister Marie set out from London with a young English novice for France. They arrived in Lyon on the 15th of August 1861 and received hospitality from the Marist Fathers at 4 Monte San Barthélemy at the foot of the hill of Fourvière. A disappointment awaited them there. Bishop Villard had found sisters in New Zealand to take charge of his schools. Father Favre, Superior General of the Society of Mary, saw God's hand in this setback. Instead of setting out for a mission land, Sister Marie would found a new congregation. On the 25th of December, 1861, at No. 7 Rue Kléber, near the shrine of Lady of Fourvière, Mother Mary of the Heart of Jesus, Euphrosie Barbier, with her companion Sister Mary Winfred, took the habit of the Sisters of Our Lady of the Missions, Notre Dame des Missions, and started her novitiate. A new missionary congregation of women came to birth. Euphrosie called her new congregation Our Lady of the Missions, a name rich in significance and expressing the congregation's special character and spirit. For her, every mission has its source in God, Trinity. She wished her sisters to participate in a particular way, in the mission of the Incarnate Word sent by God to redeem the human race, and in the divine mission of the Spirit in the Church and in the world. The name of the congregation is profoundly significant and is the source of all Rndm life, mission, and works. To quote Euphrosie's words, "In placing themselves under the patronage of Our Lady of the Missions, the sisters desire to honor in a special way the divine mission which were the object of the ardent desires of Mary." Euphrosie again highlights the meaning anew to avoid any superficial understanding. This title immediately suggests to ordinary people that we are vowed to the foreign missions, under the protection of the Blessed Virgin, but for us, it has a much deeper meaning. Mission means sending. Angel means sent. Apostle also. Yet the only one sent was God. The Father sent the Son. The Father and the Son sent the Holy Spirit. But these three persons are inseparable and work together for the sanctification of all people. This is the reason for the existence of the congregation and its special form, as much for the interior as for the exterior. The text is important for understanding Euphrosie Barbier's essential inspiration and profound vision for the existence and mission of the Rndm congregation. From 1862, Euphrosie Barbier continues to establish her congregation on a firm basis. She adopts the rule of Saint Augustine and begins drafting the constitutions. This is submitted to Rome for approval, and on June the 9th, 1869, the laudatory brief is granted to this young congregation. Later, in 1888, Euphrasie revisits the constitutions in the light of her experience of mission life. In 1890, a first degree endorsement is granted by Rome, and it is not until after her death that the final approbation is granted by Pope Pius X in 1906. In 1864, supported spiritually and financially by the Society of Mary, with a view to forming young women for their mission in Oceania, Euphrasie sends the first four sisters of Our Lady of the Missions from Lyon to the congregation's first mission in Napier, New Zealand. From this time, many foundations grew, and the apostolate of education continued to flourish throughout New Zealand, Sydney, Australia, and the Pacific Isles. Not content with sending her sisters to the ends of the earth, she sets out as soon as possible to visit them. Enduring long sea voyages, sickness, and shipwrecks, she had established missions in Central Oceania, Tonga, Apia, Samoa, Futuna, and Wallis. And in spite of her desire for a collaborative and fruitful partnership with the Marist Fathers, Euphrasie's clear vision and strong will clashed with a different theology and focus. Determined not to relinquish her concept of mission, which combines the contemplative and active dimensions, she is nevertheless eventually forced to withdraw her sisters from Sydney, Australia, and from Central Oceania. During 1879, in spite of a period of persecution against religious in France, the mission of the congregation continued to develop. Euphrasie opened an orphanage in Deal, Kent, and later she established a foundation in Sturry, near Canterbury, and in Armentières, northern France. In 1883, Euphrasie travelled to India to establish the first foundation in Chittagong, East Bengal, where the sisters opened an orphanage for young girls. From India, she travelled for the second time to New Zealand. On her return journey, she revisits Chittagong and also Akya Burma, Myanmar, with a view to establishing a foundation. She travelled on to Dhaka and Calcutta, where she embarks the ship for her return voyage to France. After an absence of 4 years, she arrived back in Lyon in February 1887. With the wealth of experience she'd accumulated since the founding of the congregation, the discernment of vocations and the formation of young missionaries remained at the forefront of her thoughts and planning. The primary work of the sisters, whether in New Zealand, India, France, or England, is the empowerment of women and the care of children. Education, both formal and informal, is central to the missionary work of the congregation. In 1892, Euphrasie Barbier made her last visit to England, which marked the final stage of her missionary pilgrimage before the call to meet with her God. On the 18th of January, 1893, Euphrasie Barbier said her final farewell to the sisters gathered in Sturry, England, with the words, "Be very united on earth, so as to be united for all eternity." She is buried alongside the altar in the convent chapel. On the tombstone is engraved a sentence which is simple and rich in hope. Her memory is in benediction.
Let us walk by the light of the star. Let us walk by the light of the star.
So with the second Superior General, Sister Mother Mary of the Holy Rosary, some of the missions that were beginning to be considered by Euphrasie Barbier were actually opened, and so Euphrasie Barbier herself had travelled to Akya in Myanmar, and this mission was opened in the early years of the mandate of Mother Mary of the Holy Rosary. And so that was an expansion from the mission in India that had been established in Chittagong. We also had new missions in Canada and Australia. And so it was quite an expansive vision that was undertaken during this period of time. And alongside that, the growth of the congregation meant that we could establish new foundations in the already existing countries where we were present, so particularly in New Zealand and in the British Isles.
During a time of stability from 1938 to 1966, new foundations continued to grow, especially in Europe and Asia, as the number of sisters working in the different missions throughout the world increased. By 1966, the congregation had reached its peak with a total of 1,243 members. Numerically, the congregation had developed fast during this period, and as each area grew and developed, it was in a position to expand its own structures and supply its own resources in the area of personnel and material goods. Stability in works and in other areas of activity took preference over the original mission thrust of the congregation, so that movement outside the sisters' country of origin, mission beyond boundaries, lessened. This period is also marked by the departure of RNDM foreign missionaries from Burma and from North Vietnam in 1954. Political, social, economic, and religious influences affected the congregation at this time. After the Second Vatican Council and the call to return to the original insight of their foundation, the congregation, conscious of the slowing down of the primary missionary trust throughout the RNDM world, were again challenged to rekindle the flame of the missionary zeal of Euphra Zibabie and the first generation of sisters. The missionary desire at this time was to be present to and journey with the grassroots poor, particularly women and children, youth, refugees, indigenous people of the world of the day. New mission areas were established as Australia moved towards Papua New Guinea, Canada towards Peru, New Zealand recovers a foothold in Samoa, British Isles reaches towards Kenya, France to Senegal, and India moves towards Bihar to live and work among the Harijans and Dalits, the most marginalized peoples of the world at that time. The General Administration House of the Congregation was transferred from England to Rome. During this time of renewal and hope, the congregation, in spite of difficulties, numerical decline, struggle, departures and loss of personnel, slowness and or resistance to change, rediscovered Euphra Zibabie's original inspiration at its source. From 1984 onwards, this return to our beginnings has given birth to a fresh and energizing missionary trust. A profound spiritual, personal and collective renewal, and a new wave of missionary dynamism. It was at this time RNDMs started a foundation in the Philippines, a new mission area for RNDMs. During the past 30 years, international gatherings stand out as landmarks along the journey of the congregation. In 2006, Ballet Euphrasie, an international formation centre providing programmes for sisters preparing for final vows, for ongoing formation and for those moving beyond their own countries, was opened. Missionary dynamism and internationality brings richness in the concrete reality of the countries and social environments in which the congregation is now established. RNDMs find themselves confronted by issues of injustice, the depletion of creation, and the effects of globalization, as well as other enormous challenges of our 21st century. In the world of today, RNDMs take courageous and prophetic positions which confront situations of injustice and exploitation. Throughout 150 years, the emergence of the congregation has changed. French in origin, it developed mainly in English-speaking countries. New Zealand, British Isles and Ireland, Australia and Canada. Countries characterized by techno-scientific development and faced with economic and political problems to an extent that is without precedent. Today, the strength and future of the congregation is in the East and South, where RNDM presence and missions in India, Vietnam, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Kenya, Senegal, Sudan, Peru, Bolivia, and Philippines are the center of religious and missionary formation, with the possibility of engaging and challenging the RNDM world in a different way. In 2009, the congregation was again challenged to dare to imagine new impetus for mission in the call to become an RNDM Earth community, a gift of God to the congregation at this time. Sharing in the fragility and abundance of the earth, RNDMs are invited to a more holistic way of living and seeing life, as inhabitants of the earth, in contemplation with God, in communion with one another, in mission as befriending others and the earth. We find ourselves as congregation once again daring to respond to the challenge to live the reality that mission is not individual to any one place, age, culture, religion and country. Our RNDM mission is inclusive and interconnected, full of possibility as we become accountable to the whole. This approach holds no boundaries and offers a vast horizon of partnership and collaboration. In 2010, the Congregation of Our Lady of the Missions has recognized that in partnership with the Earth and many others, we have the vision and capacity to engage with the challenges of our time in increasingly life-enhancing ways. We have again embraced a daring to share our charism beyond our membership as we move towards new initiatives and open new missions in areas of greatest need. May 2010 saw the opening of a mission in Koh Thong on the Thai-Myanmar border, with RNDMs and Maoist priests working in partnership to help empower and bring assistance to border dwellers with HIV/AIDS and those with other specific needs, with particular care of women and children. The opening in Laos in the Diocese of Paksa in May 2010 enabled RNDM to join others in building a relationship with the local people and sharing a presence that brings hope to those in need. Early in 2010, RNDMs take responsibility for running a school for kindergarten children with HIV/AIDS in the slum area of Kibera, Nairobi. Later in 2010, we open a mission in Sambalpur in Orissa on the east coast of India. The sisters work for the betterment of the underprivileged and those experiencing hardship on the edge, particularly children who drop out from school. Further plans are in progress for RNDMs to become a presence and part of a mission to promote the education and formation of women and children, as well as to enhance human rights in China and Kazakhstan, as well as opening additional missions in southern Sudan, North Karnataka and Tamil Nadu in India, and in new areas in Bangladesh. To live consciously as an Rndm Earth community in this third millennium challenges members to promote human rights, economic justice, a culture of reconciliation and peace, a respect for Earth, a nurturing of human dignity, along with the human and spiritual well-being of all its inhabitants. After 150 years, God continues to speak to Rndms through the challenges of our world, revealed in the faces of the poor and those on the margins of church and society, particularly women and children. The invitation remains open to journey with the poor in possessions, poor in relationships, poor in faith, who are with us no matter where we are. We continue to listen and discern how we are continually called to live and act in an ever-evolving and changing world. Let ours be a time remembered for awakening a new respect for our Earth and all her inhabitants, for one another, for ourselves, and for our common destiny.
Naturally, we must get together. Naturally, we must go.